Your body is made up of trillions of cells which differ in appearance depending on their function. However, most cells are made up of the same elements and behave in similar ways. Each cell here has a nucleus which controls and regulates all the cell's functions and is surrounded by a membrane which controls what enters and leaves the cell. Cells reproduce by dividing, producing two identical cells. You can see this process happening here. The cell nucleus splits in half, and the parts then separate to form two new cells. At the front of each eye is a transparent curved area called the cornea, which allows light to enter the eye. The colored part of the eye, the iris, lies behind the cornea and controls the amount of light entering the eye. At its center is a black hole, the pupil. In dim light, muscle fibers in the iris make the pupil larger in order to allow as much light as possible into the eye. In bright light, another set of muscle fibers make the pupil shrink so that less light enters the eye. This ensures that the eye is not damaged by too much light. Fertilization marks the beginning of a new human life. It takes place when a male sex cell, the sperm, meets and fuses with a female sex cell, the egg or ovum. Each sperm consists of a head region that carries half the instructions needed to make a baby, a long tail or flagellum that beats vigorously to push the sperm forwards towards the egg, and a tiny midpiece that supplies it with energy. When sperm find an egg, they immediately start burrowing into it. Eventually, a single sperm penetrates the egg. The head region of the sperm fuses with the nucleus of the egg, and fertilization has taken place. The hairs on our head and body are tough cylinders of dead cells that grow from deep pits in the skin called hair follicles. The color of a hair depends on how much of the dark pigment melanin it contains, ranging from very little in blonde hair to large amounts in black hair. The part of the hair that we can see is called the shaft. The shaft grows upwards from the hair follicle until it emerges from an opening in the skin surface. Your heart pumps blood to every part of your body, supplying all of its cells with the oxygen and food they need to function. The heart is made of a special type of tissue called cardiac muscle. This muscle contracts continuously and rhythmically of its own accord, without stopping for rest, allowing your heart to beat constantly. As the muscles in the heart wall contract, they squeeze the blood out, pushing it to the lungs and to the rest of the body. When they relax, blood is taken into the heart. The flow of blood through the heart is controlled by valves, which allow blood to pass through in one direction only. Your heart is made up of a special type of muscle called cardiac muscle. Here you can see cardiac muscle cells that have been isolated and placed under a microscope. Despite being isolated from other body tissue, they're still contracting. This is because their action is myogenic, which means that they're able to contract automatically without instructions to do so from your brain or any other part of your nervous system. This is one of the things that makes cardiac muscle different from your other muscles, which require nerve impulses from your nervous system to function. However, if cardiac muscles are deprived of oxygen, as they have been here, their beating slows down and eventually stops completely. This is what happens when someone suffers a heart attack. Heat is being released constantly from all our tissues as they undertake the work of maintaining and moving the body. When we exercise, the amount of heat released by our muscles increases because they have to work harder. This means the amount of heat lost through the skin also increases. We can see this increased heat loss by using an imaging technique called thermography, which produces a heat picture of the body. The coolest places are colored blue, changing to green, red, orange, pink, and finally white as the body gets warmer. Today, there are many imaging techniques available that allow doctors to examine the inside of a patient's body without having to use surgery. An MRI scan of the heart is produced by exposing the subject to a strong magnetic field and displaying the results on a computer screen. In this CAT scan of the brain, X-rays are used to view a thin slice through the skull, starting at the top of the head and moving down towards the neck. One of the most commonly used forms of imaging is an ultrasound scan, which is cheap and versatile, using reflected sound waves to investigate the body. Here it is used to display a beating heart. Your skeleton has to be strong and rigid to support your body and keep you upright. But it is also flexible because where the bones meet, they form joints which permit varying degrees of movement. The bones of your joints are held together by strong fibers called ligaments. Hinge joints like the knee, the largest joint in your body, allow only forward and backward movement in one direction. Ball and socket joints, like those of the shoulder and hip, allow greater freedom of movement as one bone rotates inside the socket formed by the other. Some parts of the body, such as the wrist and ankle, combine lots of small sliding joints to allow movement in several directions. The nervous system is formed out of billions of nerve cells like the ones that you can see here. The branching ends of these cells are used to form connections with many other cells, forming a network that extends throughout the whole body. A nerve is made up of groups of cells bundled together. Some nerve cells extend the entire length of the nerve and can be almost a meter long. During pregnancy, a baby develops from a fertilized egg inside its mother's womb or uterus. It receives oxygen and nutrients from its mother's body through the umbilical cord. At 7 weeks, the developing eye can be seen and the embryo's heart is beating. After 5 months of development, the fetus's face is fully formed, with the lips and nose visible. Doctors can use an ultrasound scan to examine an unborn baby. Here, the fetus's arm and hand are clearly visible. Finally, after 9 months in the womb, a baby is fully developed and is ready to be born. The circulatory system transports blood around the body, carrying oxygen to all the tissues. Each one of the trillions of red blood cells or erythrocytes circulating around the body is disc-shaped with a flattened center, something like a miniature donut. Red blood cells are carried through the body's tissues by tiny blood vessels called capillaries. Many capillaries are only just wider than the red blood cells themselves, so that the blood cells queue up as they unload their precious cargo to the surrounding tissues before being carried back to the lungs to obtain fresh oxygen supplies. When you walk or run, the arch of your foot pushes down against the ground, providing a forward thrust which is accompanied by your leg being raised at the hip. The knee joint then swings your lower leg out in front of you so that when your leg is lowered again from the hip, your foot is further forward than it was. The knee is cushioned by a layer of cartilage and fluid called synovial fluid, which allows it to absorb the impact as the foot hits the ground, preventing damage to the joint. Each step you take in this way moves you further forward. Our bodies are covered by skin, a waterproof, germ-proof overcoat that protects us and helps keep us warm. To the naked eye, skin appears fairly smooth, with a few creases and wrinkles. But what is it really like? This view of the skin, seen through an electron microscope, reveals a rugged landscape filled with hills and valleys. The masses of small spherical objects found huddled together are groups of bacteria which lead a harmless existence on the skin's surface. Food and drink enter the body through the mouth. Here, the subject is ingesting a mixture containing the substance barium sulfate, which shows up well in X-ray photography. Here, the mixture is chewed by the back teeth and is then pushed back by the tongue to the throat, where it is swallowed. Once in the esophagus, a process called peristalsis pushes it down towards the stomach in a series of muscular contractions. We use our vocal cords to make sounds. In order to look at the vocal cords, doctors pass a viewing tube called an endoscope down the throat and into the larynx. The two vocal cords are stretched across the larynx, and during normal breathing, the space between the vocal cords, or glottis, is very wide. When we want to make sounds, muscles in the larynx bring the vocal cords closer together. As we breathe out, air rushing upward from the lungs makes the vocal cords vibrate and produce sounds.